I have to have two microphones, apparently. And one of them is attached, so if I trip, because I... Yeah. Thank you. Will they talk to each other? Okay. So let's just see how far this goes, because I'm a little bit weird about walking. Hi. Hi. First of all, I just want to say I've had an incredibly great day so far. I can't believe how happy I am to be here, even though I've been here before. I mean, what I mean is I'm really having a good time. I am not someone who actually lies. I do also want to say ahead of time, I apologize for my talk because it isn't. It's mostly about what I do and a little bit. We use big data, and so I'm going to talk about what we do with big data, but it's not just big data. So if there's anybody here who just wants really deep insights into big data, you know, it's fine if you, is there a back door? also, it's an interdisciplinary, so I'm for those who know a lot about what I'm talking about, it's going to sound a little different, but I'm hoping that somebody will get something. Each person will get something, just one thing, out of it. So that's my apology. And here, where is my talk? That's not it. Usually it's already up here, and here it is. And it's called My Winnipeg, because my neighbor in Cambridge recently is Guy Madden, who's he lives around the corner, and just so I thought, since he is so cool, that I would call it my Winnipeg, and then I thought people would think I was a little bit weird, which I am, and then they would know how weird I was, and then there's also the back door. Okay, sorry for the technical stuff here. Okay. Okay, what is going on? Sorry. Okay, we're all okay. And look what I have here. It's just now I have two things. And honestly, I'm not sure my brain is capable of doing two things at the same time. So much data, so little information. I know that sounds a little bit depressing. Our experiment at the Large Hadron Collider has an enormous amount of data, and I'll show you exactly how much. Big data doesn't even... it's very, very big. And what we do with our data is try and make it very, very small. So we don't celebrate the fact that it's big. We try to hide the fact that it's big because it being big just takes us a long time. So I'm going to talk about the case of finding the Higgs boson, and that's just really a vehicle in order to talk about the tiny data we get from the big data, which is so good. I guess I should point it at the thing, which now doesn't work. Oh, because you have to turn it on. I love that part of a technology that has to be on. Okay, so I study small particles, so none of these things, not interesting. Although these are interesting to some of you, I mean, they're objectively fascinating, not interesting to me. I'm not interested in the structure of the atom. I'm not even really interested in the proton anymore. I'm just interested in the things inside. I'm interested in these. So there's the atom with electrons and a nucleus. And I'm interested in the things inside the nucleon, which are quarks. And I'm interested in what you can do with them in order to further our interest in physics. And so here's my world. This is the world of all elementary particles. We have the six quarks and the six leptons. So quarks are, for instance, the things that are inside the neutron and proton. And the leptons are very light particles, like the electron, which do other things and which are there to make atoms work. And then they're there for some reason, who knows why. Then there's the particles, the photon, the gluon, the W and the Z, which act as intermediaries to carry the forces by which, through which these particles interact with each other. And then finally, we found this one in the middle, which interacts with all these particles, not the photon directly, which is the Higgs boson. And so this is sort of my entire world. What people are really looking for is that this is just one thing. People are kind of upset that there are six quarks and six leptons, and they would like there to be only one force in the world, and those things are called theorists. I'm an experimentalist, and so that'll become clear throughout this talk, I think. So here's sort of my image of myself. Here's the standard model again in box form. When I was a kid at University of Toronto, the charm quark was discovered, and people came to University of Toronto and told us about it. We all went crazy. It was so exciting. It was the first time people actually thought quarks were real. And so I went into particle physics, and then I worked for a guy in the summer that I met. He had two experiments, one at Fermi Lab, which is in Chicago, and one at CERN, which is in Geneva, Switzerland. And I wanted to go to Geneva, so I worked there. He discovered the bottom quark that summer in Chicago. So I still hadn't discovered a quark, and I really wanted to discover a quark. It took 25 years before I was part of the 600-person experiment that discovered the top quark, and then that's it. There are no quarks, so if there's any young people here, forget it. There's only six. You're going to have to find something else. That's OK. The only other thing to say about this is that all the quarks were discovered in North America, and all the force carriers were discovered in Europe. I don't know if that's deep or not. Anyhow, here is me discovering the top quark. This is before I had children. And then here's me with the Dirac equation, trying to understand field theory. OK, so this is, we're complicated physicists. So what do I really want to talk about? I'm most interested in the vacuum. So I'm most interested in not those particles. Turns out those particles are only 4% of the universe. Forget it. I wasted my life. But now we got the particles. So what I'm really interested in, you take all the particles out of the world, everything, all the matter, what do you have? That's a really interesting question. That's the question I'm going to answer today. And then you will know. This is so weird, isn't it? Do I seem like a rock star, though, a little bit? Just going back and forth? Okay. So anyhow, I showed the, this is sort of also kind of a literary thing. This is what Samuel Beckett, one of my favorite authors, used to do. He wanted to understand, if you take almost everything out of the world, what do you have left? And he did it, in this case, with two people. Remember Waiting for Godot? No? Yeah. And he eventually, Samuel Beckett, took everybody out until he had just the nameless, the unnameable. So I feel like somehow we're intellectuals when we're doing this, even though actually we just build big detectors and smash things. So here's a theorist. Clearly conflicted, complicated, sits in their office. And they write down the equations of the standard model. Here's the Lagrangian of the standard model. This is the one equation which describes everything about all those particles. Kind of nice. I just thought you've probably never heard an equation read aloud. Okay, I won't do it. It is really exciting. You know, try it when you go home today. Look up the Lagrangian of the standard model and just read it aloud. It's very beautiful. Anyhow, there is an equation which describes this world, and there was something missing in this equation. And you can either write the equation or you can write a Feynman diagram to describe everything that's happening in that equation. And here, for instance, is a diagram which explains how an electron and its antimatter partner, the positron, annihilate to make a photon and then make a muon and an antimuon. And everything we do is try and make things like this happen and then count how many times they happen and then check with the theorists and see whether it makes sense. So here's a theorist. He's cute. As theorists go, I would say he's like a, okay, okay, this is Peter Higgs. A bunch of people were trying to solve a problem in symmetry breaking. And what they came up was there's perhaps something called there's perhaps a field in the vacuum. When you take all the matter out, perhaps there's a field of something which has no direction, and you can't see it or feel it, you can't touch it. It's not like corduroy. And so what he suggested was, if there was such a field in the vacuum, there could be an excitation of the field called the Higgs boson, and we could look for it. And this is basically what a Canadian, I don't know if he's Canadian, he works at the perimeter. His one slide from Minute Physics, it's a really great thing that's on the computer thing, internet. And basically it says that we have this Lagrangian, which I just showed you, plus adding the Higgs field to it, okay, supposing there is a Higgs field, you put it in a big machine, which is could be a theorist. But this is cuter, I think. And then what comes out is a Higgs boson. And what also happens is that all the elementary particles, which in our theory did not have any mass before, but we actually measured them to have mass, actually acquire a mass in the theory. So we're very happy. So this is the only theory I will be talking about. That's it. There are no equations. So all I have to do to understand the vacuum, what's in the vacuum, to see if there's a Higgs field in the vacuum, is to make this. So I just want to just explain a little bit the connection between experimentalists and theorists in my field, which is physics. I hope that's not my fault. That would be really bad. It's okay. Everything's going to be fine. When I was young, I met some theorists, and they said this. They said, the theorist is like the truffle farmer. Do you know what truffles are? They're expensive. And they're like things you get in the ground in France or Italy. And so the theorist is like a truffle farmer, and the experimentalists are like the truffle pigs. So the farmer knows where the truffles roughly are going to be, and the pigs are really good at snorting them out, snuffling them out. So the theorist takes the experimentalists to the truffle place, and the experimentalist gets them, and then the theorist takes a stick and hits the pig and takes the truffle. So, I think this might help. I, at that moment, and I was quite young and still impressionable, decided to be a bad pig. I would be a pig that wouldn't listen to theorists and would make fun of them all the time. And, which is pretty easy to do. So when I was in the shower, I would think about this, being a bad pig, and not listening to theory. And then, of course, I would love Dirac, so I was thinking, well, how does that work? He's a theorist. And here's me in the lab. And so I've changed into a good pig just recently. I've wasted my life in bad pigdom. Okay, so what is a field? I told you I was going to find a field, and you guys are thinking in biology, like, what's she talking about? So I wanted to do an example of a field would be a wind field. So there's a great... So here's America. Here's the United States of America, by the way, which just didn't pass the, just in case not if anybody did not pass the bill, the repeal of Obamacare bill. So yay, yay for now. Okay. Anyway, we're not talking about politics. Here's the thing. What is a field? So here, this shows that at every point in space. Wow. Look. At every point in space, there's a strength and a direction of wind, okay? So you can sort of say, I can say everywhere in the world, I can measure the wind direction and strength, and that I will call the wind field, okay? And so if I have an electromagnetic field that I know at every point in space, I know the direction and the strength, I can say that is a field. So with this field, with the wind field, I can say, well, we want to understand the Higgs field in the vacuum. So we want to make a momentary disturbance in the field. It's called the Higgs boson. And so this short-lived particle would be our tornado. So if a tornado, for instance, is an excitation in the wind field, like it's obviously a little bit different than just normal wind, then I would look for the equivalent tornado from the Higgs field. I can't see the Higgs field. I can feel the wind on my face, but I can't feel the Higgs field on my face. I've tried a lot, even when taking scotch, for instance. You can try and feel the Higgs, but you can't. Okay, so what are we going to do? Is this okay? Yeah. Okay, so what are we going to do? What is the Higgs boson? First of all, it's a particle. What is a particle? So a particle is it like an excitation? A particle isn't a thing that's there forever. Interesting particles decay, except for the electron and the proton, which would be bad if they decayed. So here's a particle. Oops, here's a particle. Usually it has a quantum mechanical spin. The Higgs boson actually has no spin, so I don't have to talk about spin. So what is a particle like? So I'm going to argue, again by analogy, that a particle is like the resonance of a wine glass, usually without any wine in it. Do you know this? When you sing to the wine glass, it resonates. And if you sing and you stop singing, it'll resonate for a while and it'll stop resonating. And it turns out that if you look at the power absorbed by the wine glass as a function of the frequency with which you sing, it looks like this. So there's some frequency that it loves to absorb the power and oscillate, okay? And there's some other frequencies which it doesn't. And then the width of this sort of bell curve tells you something about the lifetime of the resonance. That is, how long after you stop singing will the oscillation go away? Is that okay? So the exact same thing is true for particles. But first of all, I want to just show you a nice video because I like it. Because probably maybe have seen this, maybe not. We did this just in the lecture hall. So we have a strobe light on a wine glass, and we're making. Do you want the noise? I don't have the noise. Oh, I need the noise. Here. Not for this, but for something else. There you go. Can you see it? Isn't that cool? Did you see that? That's really. Yeah. So this is the resonating wine glass, right? And you can break it too, but I didn't want to break it for you because I know how sensitive Canadians are. I am a Canadian. You know that, right? So for a particle resonance, when I want to look for a particle, I want to look for exactly the same shape of a resonance curve, but instead of having the power being absorbed by the glass, versus the frequency at which I'm singing, this is going to be a little bit different. I'm going to look at the number of such particles I see, such examples of particles I see, the number of events, versus the characteristic invariant mass of the particle. Every particle has a mass that doesn't change no matter how much you speed it up. Okay? And that's the mass here. And the width of this, again, is 1 over the lifetime of the particle. So the particle will have a lifetime. It will decay, and it will have a characteristic mass. So if I want to find a particle, and that particle, Higgs boson, would be my tornado, I better look for something like this. Okay? Great. So I can't remember why I'm talking about this. Oh, I'm going to look for the Higgs particle. Okay, no, I know why. Because I'm going to show you how we found the Z here, just to show you that this is true, the Z and the top quark. And here's the Z. So again, there's a characteristic 90 GeV mass of the Z particle. It decays to electron positron. And you see it has this shape. And we know the particle exists, and we're very happy. And someone got a Nobel Prize. I didn't. OK, the Z only lasts about 10 to the minus 22 seconds, which is small. For any biologists in the audience, it's way smaller than it needs to be. Okay, here's the top quark mass. Again, it has this nice shape. Well, okay, there's this tail, but don't worry, we can explain that. Again, this is a particle resonance called the top quark. It's weird, it's 175 GeV, 175 times the proton mass. So it's an elementary particle which is 200 times more massive than the proton, which is kind of weird. Anyhow, you see the whole idea, right? Okay, so if I excite the Higgs field, I'll get the Higgs boson. That's my idea. I'll understand whether there's a field in the vacuum, and then I'll be happy before I die. So what does it take? Well, I have to take a huge amount of energy at a very small place in a very short amount of time, and then it's basically marquee. You guys don't like martinis? That's so old-fashioned. I know, I'm old. Young people don't drink martinis. Okay, here's what I'm going to do. Is the hour over yet? Are we having fun? Is anybody feeling sad? No. Okay. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to make a huge amount of energy. I'm going to take the highest energy beams of particles ever made, which are 12.5 billion electron volts each. I'm going to collide these beams together. These are beams of protons because they're easy to play with. And then I'm going to collide them in the middle here. And then I'm going to see what comes out. And possibly this particle will be made if I do this enough time. So this is my strategy, okay? I make this disturbance by, the field is always there. I just make some crazy ass energy at some point into the field and I see what happens. So what do I need? I need the Large Hadron Collider, which is in Geneva, Switzerland. And I need to be able to turn it on. It is the energy frontier. Anything that we learn that's interesting. There's lots of interesting things happening, but this is the most interesting. No. Okay. Physics is all good. And biology. Chemistry, I don't know. I was just kidding. I hope that's okay. Okay. Here is the, this is just outside of Geneva. Geneva's down here. You can get go. There's a huge fountain there. And this is just drawn on top of the French countryside here. And underneath, 100 meters down, is the accelerator tunnel and the accelerator. And then there's also like the Mont Blanc, which is like people wrote poems about that, in case you like poems. Here I just put the size of the collider on Winnipeg. I don't know if this means anything to you. But I think that's the airport. So you can see that it's rather large, and you have to drive a lot. Okay. What happens is that there are four experiments, and they're all underground. I'm not really interested. There's only two I'm interested in, CMS and ATLAS. They're both multi-purpose experiments, and the reason you have two, even though they cost an enormous amount of money, like millions of dollars to make these experiments, and years, like 15 years to make each one, well, if we find something, and there wasn't this experiment, then we'd have to wait another 15 years until they built another experiment in order for them to reproduce it. And we can't wait that long because we'll be dead. So we always put two experiments at the same time. Okay? This here is the beams, the protons and protons collide at here, and here. Oh, underneath there, right there. And we collide the beams every 25 nanoseconds for a year or two or three. Nanoseconds are small. Particle physicists are really, we're on the frontier and we take that seriously. So we all wear cowboy hats. This is a fabulous, I mean, can you believe this Time magazine has a particle physicist? That's so great. Anyway, she's now the fearless leader of CERN. I put the hat on. She could be a cowboy. Wow. So when we collide the particles, when we collide the protons, lots of things happen. A lot of charged particles come out, and we always put a magnetic field so we can, so we can measure the momentum of the charged particles. Because if you put particles in a magnetic field, they'll bend depending on their momentum. So this is sort of the kind of thing that happens. Then we have to think of, well, what do we need to put around this particle collision in order to measure stuff? This is my experiment. These are small French people. They're actually, French people are not that small. Here's where the collisions take place. This is five stories high. When you go up in the lift aloft to work on something, you have to wear a diaper because it's so scary. We built these things at Harvard here. There are lots of countries, 38 countries, built different parts of this and put it all together. It's very fun, and people have great, hilarious accents. I love accents. Anyhow, look at this part here. Here's where they collide. And around here, all these particles come out, and you really want to measure each one really carefully. So what do? Everything in our experiment is ionization. Ionization is just like you have an atom. It has electrons. And if you knock an electron off, you've ionized. Okay? So every time you have a charged particle going through a gas or a silicon or anything else, you ionize it. And we follow the trail of ionization. So it's just a trail of ionization story, that old story of the trail of ionization. So here's where things collide. Here's an atom. Here's a charged particle bending in a magnetic field. So those are the only things we need to know. Atom, ionization, charged particle. We start here. We track these particles really well with tracking devices. Then we measure their energy, then we see if they're muons. And this is a huge experiment. It's just a piece of it, okay? So this is the part I want to, in terms of big data, this is the part I want to talk about, because this is the part that's going to have 70 million channels of electronics readout. And you can see if you have 70 million channels, well, actually the whole experiment is 100 million channels, and you're colliding particles every 25 nanoseconds, so that's 40 megahertz. So you can see that if you recorded every single event, you couldn't. It'd be too much. So that's where big data comes in. So this is what actually is happening. Here are the two beams. At some point they collide. There, things, protons come in bunches, 10 to the 11th protons in each bunch. That's a lot. The proton, they're protons, but they're not, we don't think of them as protons. They're just quarks and gluons in a bag, but there is no bag. The kind of, I love that, where you take the bag away at the end. You put it in and then you take it out. So the quarks or the gluons collide with each other, and once in a while, once in 10 trillion times you collide the protons, you create a Higgs boson. That's the likelihood. There's a lot of data, but we're looking for something really small. So in particular, one thing we can't do is record every event, especially the uninteresting event. So another problem is that when you collide 10 to the 11th protons on 10 to the 11th protons, you're going to have way more than one proton-proton collision. It's going to look more like this, where every vertex here is a proton-proton collision, but only maybe one of them is going to be interesting. Okay. Okay. So 40, the bunches cross 40 million times a second. There are about 20 to 40 collisions per crossing. There's about 1 billion collisions per second. Each raw event is 2 megabytes of data. The data per second is 2 terabytes per second, if I took every single one. So this data rate is equivalent to taking 50 billion telephone calls at the same time. This is not what we want to do. And so we need help. So we have to define interesting and then reduce our data by only triggering on interesting events. I just want to show you how big it is. This is like, how big is yours? Here's LHC. Do you know what a petabyte is? What's a petabyte? 10 to the tera is? Okay, giga is 9, tera is 12, 15. Right, obviously, peta. 15 petabytes per year is what we actually record from the Large Hadron Collider. Facebook uploads per year 180 petabytes per year. Business emails sent. We don't know about the NSA because NSA is the, I don't know if you know it, that's the American National Security Agency, which listens to everything I say, and every American, and even some Canadians, some British people, Russians. Anyway, we don't know how big that is, so we put it in a square. But you see, LHC is, when you think about big data, there's nothing else in science that really, and this is the, not, this is the data after we've already slimmed it down by putting in a trigger. So this is pretty big. Okay, so how big is it? We need to select what we're looking for. We need what's called a trigger. I just want to go back a step because I love this story and I thought for anyone not liking the talk, they would at least like this story. So this is about the discovery of cosmic rays. There was a guy who was using things called electroscopes or electrometers. They basically just measure charge. So you want to measure the charge on like a piece of fur or something, or charge on something. And what happens when you charge this thing up, this little needle will go up, okay? And this guy, Victor Hess, realized that he couldn't really do good charge measurements because the needle kept going down after it would go up. And then after a while, it would slowly go down. And he couldn't understand why. And eventually, he figured, well, I think his might have looked more like this. I love his little thing here. Victor Hess had very nice blouses. So he was thinking, well, maybe radiation from the Earth is going through this and ionizing the gas in here. And those ions would then neutralize the charge and it would start going down. So he said, oh, this is, we know there's radioactivity, we know there's the Earth. What do you do? You're not all saying it together? You have your electroscope, you want to check your theory, you go in a balloon. Obviously. You take your electroscope and your charging thing, and you go up in a balloon, and at different heights, you measure how fast the electroscope decays away. And you can measure the ionizing, essentially the number of ion pairs that are being produced by ionizing radiation. And he found at the beginning, this is him, he's very cute, the mustache and everything, obviously an experimentalist. What he found, this is the number of ion pairs, and this is the height. What he found was as you go away from the Earth, it actually goes down. The number of, you know, the speed at which it goes down. And then it starts going up and up and up and up. And so this, what they realized was as you go up in a balloon, you start getting more and more cosmic rays, cosmic radiation coming down. OK, why am I telling you this story? I love this story. Because you have, this is a very, very, very crude way of measuring anything. And we have a very uncrude way where we can actually see the particles. And what we can do is we can create a chamber where a cosmic ray will come down. And we will know that it's coming down because we will put a trigger. We will put a piece of plastic on the top and the bottom. And when a charged particle goes through, we will get a little click, click. And we will know to look in our detector when that happens, because you don't know when cosmic rays are going to come. Now, it turns out, and this is even cooler, that this is basically just using an AND gate. An AND gate is just, you know, if A is true and B is true, then F is true. It's a lovely logic thing. By saying, if this turns on and this turns on at the same time, then I have a trigger. But what is cool is that a guy got a Nobel Prize for this. It's just cool because experimentalists never get Nobel Prizes. Actually, he was a theorist who just did experiments. Isn't this beautiful, though? OK. This was the first trigger. This was this first idea of a coincidence circuit was the first trigger. So we're going to still use coincidences, but maybe a little more complicated. here's a simulation of what might happen in one of our events. There's a lot of particles coming out. And so the question is, what are you going to do to make your trigger? You know when it happens, but not every single event is interesting. So you want to ask the question. That was a simulation. This is a real event from the CMS detector. It's very beautiful. All those are charged particles. Not all of them have very high momentum, but they're all charged particles. So what we do is something very, very simple to begin with. If this is the proton going this way and this is the other one going that way, we say, well, it's got to be interesting if a huge amount of energy goes perpendicular to the beamline. Like if there's a lot of energy in this direction, something interesting must have happened, because not interesting is this. You know, you just tickle each other, just tickling, or even blowing each other up, just a little tickling. Just blowing each other up, but not being interesting, just keeping going in that direction. So basically, we create a trigger, not just that energy goes perpendicular here, but also that it goes in certain ways, that maybe there's an electron which has a lot of energy that goes perpendicular, or maybe there's a muon, or any one of those funny particles I talked about at the beginning. So we have three levels of trigger, which basically reduces the rate per second from 40 million per second to 3,000 per second. And that's incoming to these. So in the end, we have 200 hertz of interesting data. But I have to say that we throw away probably all the black holes. Well, we don't really make any black holes. I don't want to say that. Of course, there's no black holes. This is I made the trigger seem really simple, but this is actually what it looks like. This thing. You know what these are, right? Servers. Servers, not someone at a restaurant. Okay, I'm getting tired. Are you guys tired? Okay. So, here's what an event might look like. If I look end on at my proton-proton collision, I might see something in the very inner detector here. These are charged particles going out, and all these little dots are hits. And it's a huge amount of computing power that goes into tracking those hits and finding tracks, which takes a long time. That's called the reconstruction. Here, for instance, is a different view where you see it from the side. All these particles clearly came from the same vertex, and you need to find that vertex and find the momentum of all these particles. So that's sort of what we're doing when we do reconstruction. Here's the physical thing itself. I just showed this one because we built this. These are muon detectors. And I also show you this just because it's enormous. And you can see that you can't see the Mont Blanc on many days here. This is part of the muon toroid system. So it's a huge thing that took 20 years to build. And it's 3,000 physicists, and it's a flat organization. That is, there's not really any boss, and nobody kills anybody else. And it's alphabetical ordering on the papers, and it's very fun. So it's kind of surprising. Here is the central detector. I just wanted to point out, this is 6 meters. That's the very central tracking detector. But this little piece in here is the 70 million pixel silicon pixels. So 70 million is the problem of why you have 2 megabytes of data to read out for each event. And I don't know if you know about megabytes, but they're pretty big. They're big bytes. Mega. They're megabytes. Yeah. And so we take per year we have raw data, we reconstruct the data to do the tracking, et cetera, and the physics data, we have something like 10 or 9 terabytes. Sorry, petabytes per year. So that's a lot of petabytes. The CERN computing system is about 60 petabytes. So here's how it works. This is the part I find really boring. Here's my detector. Here are the French people. They're really small now. At CERN, there's a huge computing center. There, they put everything on tape, all the raw data on tape. they put it on tape because the tape, you can't screw it up. So some graduate student can't like erase it all, basically. And it lasts longer. But they also put it on disk. So that's the first computing. Then they send it to three tier one computing centers where they do whatever is not done in production here in tier zero, they do it these three big centers. And then they send it to a whole bunch of 38 tier two centers. So there's 80 sites. One at least is at Triumph in B.C. So this is our system. And in the end, at the very end, when you have users, it's like 1 megabyte per event. So this is something that exists. And here you can see Triumph here. Here's the tier zero. These are the tier two. And then these are people. These are what people look like to. They're just monitors and PCs. Yeah. So it's kind of how we do it. This is all over the world. This is sort of what it looks like. Here's tier zero. This is obviously not all of tier zero. I'm just sort of giving you, like, if you were there and you wanted to unplug something, this is where you would go to unplug it. I can't see anything here. Here's the mag tape. You know, I said they put things on tape, but if you want to access data on a tape, you have to have a robot come and get the tape. You don't want people with tapes because people get their ties caught in tapes. Does anybody remember that? Did anybody get their tie caught in a tape? Has anyone ever seen it? No? You don't remember the tapes? 6250 bits per inch? OK. And this is the servers at the CERN data center, which collected 75 petabytes of data in the last 3 years. So I'm just sort of giving you the sense of what big data looks like physically. But the 10,000 physicists use this data. On average, there's about 250,000 jobs concurrently running. Does this give the sense of something big? I don't know. Do you guys have anything like that here? So 30 million jobs ran. So a lot of these jobs actually are just graduate students doing the wrong thing. But that's how they learn. So there's 260,000 available processing cores, 180 petabytes of disk storage worldwide as part of this LHC grid computing thing, which is distributed in space and in time. So only 15% is at CERN. There's incredible optical fiber links to all the tier one, the first tier institutions. So, and then there's 70 petabytes stored at CERN itself on tape. So that sort of gives you the sense. This is, they have a, if you want, you can go online and watch real time every transaction. These are actually messages being sent from CERN to other places on those optical fibers. But is that enough about big data? Yes? OK. It's big. That's after we apply the trigger. This is somebody. I want to talk more about physics just for a second. Experimentalists sort of breathe life into by working for 20 years on a detector and making it work. We sort of breathe life into this theoretical Feynman diagram where we have a proton-proton coming in, but it's really a gluon and a gluon. And they might make a hypothetical top quark loop, which then can connect to a Higgs. Oh, I could create a Higgs. Oh, but then the Higgs is going to decay. How does it decay? It decays through a W loop to two photons, for instance. Now, that's a really weird thing. Strangely enough, theorists can actually calculate this. But we don't know what the Higgs mass is. So you can't calculate it completely. You can just calculate. If you imagine what the Higgs characteristic mass is, you can calculate this. So all we have to do is measure it. So we just look, for instance, there, we look for the final state is a photon and a photon. So we look for all cases where there's a photon and a photon. Here's the beam line. Here's the event. Here's two photons. Okay? Here, looking end on, are the two photons and all these crazy particles from all the different events overlapping. And we don't know that this is a Higgs boson, but we just take all events that look like this, and we look at their characteristic mass, because remember, that's how we know if there's a particle. And so we just look at the characteristic mass of two photons. So the two photons come from the particle, and this is the number of events. So remember, what are we looking for? A bump. This is in real time, time is a lot. So this is the number of events, and there's the Higgs boson. And here is data minus, if you just fit this line, not where the bump is, but above and below, and you subtract it, then this is the data minus it. So this thing here, this, of course, we know better now. This thing here was the discovery of the Higgs boson. So does that look like what I showed you? I mean, does that look like the bump I showed you? Do you remember the bumps? The wine glass? Does that look like that? Or does this look kind of like it? Yeah. You can see that, right? You're not. OK. So what's kind of interesting is that you can look at this and you can say, is it a Higgs boson, or is it a fluctuation, statistical fluctuation? It could be a statistical fluctuation. So how can you tell? Well, we don't know where here. We don't know what mass we're looking for. So we don't know exactly where to look. So when you, there's something called the look elsewhere effect. Do you know about this? At some point, like a long time ago, but not very long ago, but enough long ago, because it was a 30, okay. So there was some point at which some people in Sweden decided to see whether power lines made people sick. And what they did was they took anybody who lived within 300 meters of a power line, and they followed them for 30 years. And they had 800 possible illnesses that they could have. And they just waited, and they put all the numbers in. And at the end, they found one illness which had a 3 standard deviation effect, which was leukemia in children. And they said power lines cause leukemia in children. But what they hadn't taken into account is if you look in 800 places, there's some likelihood that we will just by statistics find a 3 standard deviation effect. So at the end, they weren't sure whether it was really true or not, but it certainly wasn't statistically significant. Similarly, for us, we don't know, we don't know if we're looking, if we see a bump like this, we know that we're looking on this whole, we're looking here and here and here and here and here, we're looking in a lot of places. So we have to take that into account. That's called the look elsewhere effect. So in the end, well, that's what we need to do. Let me just show you. Okay. Let's go back here. Oh, I can't go back there. Okay. I can't go back again. Okay. I'll come back to this. First, this is another way we can make the Higgs boson. You cannot believe that we would just see one bump and call it the Higgs boson. You can also have gluons making a Higgs, which decay to 2 Z bosons, which decay to 4 leptons, like 4 muons. And that's a event where there are 1, 2, 3, red line, 4 muons in our detector. So that would go into the bin for possible Higgs events. And then here would be what we see. There's a lot of background in this one. So notice there's a bump here. All the red is what we expect from other processes, and this is what we'd expect from the Higgs boson. Did that go too fast? Are you guys more convinced now? No? See, there's nothing there. So that's obviously a particle. It looks just like the bumps we were talking about. OK, so here's the question we ask ourselves. What is the probability to see what we see if the Higgs boson does not exist? So that's what this probability, the local p-value is here. This is the mass, characteristic mass of the Higgs. And what we found is that at some point at like 125 GeV, the probability that we see what we see in the data from all these different channels is 10 to the minus 9 if the Higgs does not exist. So the Higgs exists. Now we didn't get the Nobel Prize. But you have to take into account that you're looking in a lot of different places. So there's a kind of local probability, and then there's a global probability. You know, I looked here and here and here and here and here. I looked in a lot of places. So I have to take that into account to make sure that I'm not like the Swedish people. Okay. Does that make any sense? Yes. Okay. So we found a particle of mass 125 GeV. Oh, I wanted to tell you one other thing. Everything we do is blind. Okay, I'm just going to tell you this because it's really weird. And you probably don't do this. We don't trust ourselves. We have biases. So we do all our analyses blind. We don't look at the data. So for instance, if we're looking for masses of four leptons like the Higgs between here and here, we blank out this part of the spectrum and we don't look at it. That's okay. It's going to be fine. I don't know. I'm having a lot of trouble with this. Anyway, blind data, at first, people like me say, why would I be blind? I'm going to lose everything. And theorists, because I'm a bad pig, theorists will have their way. I will only look for things that theorists predict, and then I will blind out the parts that they predict. And since I am a bad pig, I don't like theorists, and therefore I won't be blind. But actually, it kind of makes sense. What you can do is you can look everywhere else in your data, in many control regions, in many sidebands, and everything, and you can say, does my data make sense there? And if it does, and I've made all of the requirements on my data, I can never change them again, I unblind, and I see whether my bump is there. And that is a very new thing, I mean, new in the past 20 years, that I think in particle physics, that I think is really a way particle physicists have of making sure they can't possibly do anything wrong because they have a great fear of making a mistake, even though most of the people who make really bad mistakes have Nobel Prizes. I mean, not from the mistake. It's weird. Anyway. Okay, so I'm almost there. We found the particle. We started feeling like the Higgs boson, there is a field. Remember, we found the particle, now there's a field. Now when you drink, or even if you don't, you can not feel the field, but you can intellectually feel the field. And this artist obviously was feeling that. We have a lot of data, and it turns out that when you have a lot of data, it makes sense to use machine learning, deep learning, whatever. And we do that. We're doing that a lot. We're working with Google Brain. We're using a lot of different techniques in machine learning, mostly in data analysis. And so when you ask people on our experiment, most of the people have used machine learning with data analysis, object like, is it an electron? Is it a muon? That kind of thing. Or in the trigger. The trigger is very complicated. I made it seem very simple. And in simulation. But so far, we have not used machine learning in production. And then these are just in case anybody's from CS. These are the things we've been using, like TensorFlow and Theano, et cetera. So I wanted to just end, sort of. I'm sorry I'm 5 minutes over. I wanted to end with what the heck are we doing? Why am I doing this, and why am I spending my life doing it? I know I want to learn about the vacuum, but there's more than that. There was a movie called Who Framed Roger Rabbit? It has both animated and non-animated things in it. It's a mixture. It's kind of cool. And someone asked me to give a talk prior to it. I said, okay, like at a movie theater. And then some guy from, okay, so I don't know what I'm going to talk about. Some guy from the New York Times called up and said, I hear you're giving a talk. well, I don't know why he was calling up, and he said, what are you going to talk about? I said, I have no idea. He said, talk about the cartoon laws of physics. I didn't know about them, but it turns out they are 23 cartoon laws of physics. And the cartoon laws of physics are things like this. Gravity doesn't work until you look down, right? As speed increases, objects can be in more than one place at the same time. An anvil always falls more slowly than a person. Do you know these laws? Okay, so these laws were actually written down by a kid at Harvard who worked on the Harvard Lampoon, but it's actually interesting. And so I got kind of interested, like, how is it possible that cartoons are funny and there are laws of physics in cartoons that make them funny, right? So I went and tried to find what Walt said about it. He's a guy. He's dead. So I just wanted to show you this one little thing here. Oops. Oh, I have to go over here, sorry. I don't know, I think this is kind of interesting.
If the viewer feels the action he is watching has some factual basis. For example, the idea that pulling a cow's tail could ring a bell hanging on her neck may seem far-fetched, but it has some basis in fact. There is an anatomical connection between the bell here and the tail here. That is the spinal column. And so it seems entirely plausible that pulling her tail would ring the bell.
Okay, so why am I showing you that? So the cartoon laws of physics all work. So finding each law of cartoon physics, you know, that's interesting, but it's not that interesting. Putting them all together and calling them the cartoon laws of physics, okay, that's a step up. But finding the overriding reason that these are the laws, and that's the fact that it's impossible but plausible, and that's what makes it funny, is pretty great, right? I mean, that's what I'm trying to do. So we find all these stupid particles, then we find out they're only 4% of the universe, then we find out all the interactions between them. We finally find the Higgs boson, but all of those things aren't enough. We want some kind of thing like it's plausible but impossible. Now, unfortunately, all our things are probably implausible but possible. They have to be possible. But I'm really looking for that one thing to explain everything that has all these in it. The theorists will tell you that it's the theory of everything, but I'm not really sure. Anyhow, I just want to tell you one more thing. If you're interested in working on the Large Hadron Collider and you're young, here's 2029. Where are we? We're here. See, it's going to be so much fun. And you know what? Right here, we're going to have 100 times the data. So you can come and play with us, and then your whole life could be working on the Large Hadron Collider, like my life was too. But thank you very much. Can I have questions, or who's in charge? I'm in charge. Yeah.
When you say crunching the data, is this more a problem in machine learning or compression?
No, so that's what I'm saying. We use machine learning in our analysis techniques mostly. We don't use it for crunching the data so far, but I think maybe we will soon. Yeah. Was that clear that there are no questions? Did the biologists find it easy to follow? Yes? I can't believe, no, you can't, don't do this to me. Come on, one question. Yeah.
From a biologist?
Yeah.
So, okay. just going through my mind, a long time ago when I took physics, because, you know, I did when you were an undergrad, they mocked the old concept of heat theory, told us particles coming along. How does the Higgs field differ from the classical concept?
Well, it definitely doesn't change the speed of anything going through the vacuum. Well, it's not really the ether. It's like electromagnetic fields everywhere. A gravitational field is also, it's like a gravitational field is not like the ether. Wasn't the ether something that should change the speed of light one way or the other? And that you needed, okay, I know, here it is. You needed the ether in order to even transmit radiation. And obviously that's not true. And obviously in all of our particle physics, we do not need any medium to transmit information, strangely. That's so deep. The biologist asked such a deep question in such a nice way, if only other biologists would ask questions.
Somewhere there was a graph of different packages of machine learning.
Yeah.
And like I saw some of the different software that are used in industry. Are all those currently used at CERN for?
Yeah, those are just on my just at CERN. I probably shouldn't have shown you those plots, but I just thought it was interesting. You know, what are people actually using? In my group, we're using TensorFlow, but in other groups, they use all the other things.
So my question is, like, is there not a unified?
No.
Like, well, why is that?
Well. So just to track the particles in the muon detector, we had four algorithms running all the time. I mean, first of all, people, we all work together nicely, but don't tell me what package to use. That's one thing. The other thing, it's just starting. It's just blossoming now. So people are trying out different things, and they happen to know different things. So we don't know what the right thing to use is so far. You know, Google is pushing TensorFlow. And they're helping us, you know, they're pushing it by, you know, trying to, you know, walk us through it. But I think we don't know yet. We're just, it's just, even though it's been going on for about 10 years, we're just starting. On our time scale, that's short. Yeah.
So the particle physics is your field. What do you think the psychic is?
Cosmology. Yes. But, you know, I just have to say that the only reason that it all works, science, and this is, and I wish Trump was listening, and is, you know, science depends on everybody being curious about different things in their own way, and in supporting all of those inquiries and all of those curiosities is how we get forward. So if everyone was like me, it would be a disaster. Like, even if there was one more person like me, it would be a disaster. But so, I mean, I know there are people who love condensed matter physicists. I don't know physics. I don't know why. But I'm so happy they're there. Yeah. And I'm so happy there are people who are trying to test every single thing about quantum mechanics, even though we know it's right. I'm so happy that they're testing every Gedanken experiment that was ever thought of by every undergraduate. I'm really happy. So I'm happy you guys are all here working on other things than me, because it's going to make it all happen in the future. So you don't have to work on this if you don't want to. But you can if you want to come. Yeah.
You said only 4% of the matter, or 4% of the universe was particles. What was the other 96%?
Yeah. So there's about 20%. It's dark matter. And dark matter is, well, we don't know what it is. We're guessing it's some kind of particles that don't interact with light, with photons, with light. Right? So it's gravitational interactions so far. There might be weak interactions. I forgot to tell you there are four forces. And it doesn't experience the strong force or the electromagnetic force. So we're hoping there's particles, and people are underground, and we're also looking for them. There's a dark matter wind going through our Earth, or we're going through it, I can't remember which. And we also look at the collider for dark matter. You look for dark matter by colliding the protons and then seeing if there's a big imbalance of we wouldn't see dark matter, but it would be missing. So it's like that thing yesterday upon the stair, I met a man who wasn't there. He wasn't there again today. I wish to hell he'd go away. Is that? Yeah. So we look for momentum imbalances to say something was created, we didn't detect it, and it either was dark matter or a neutrino or went into another dimension. Even being able to say those words makes me happy. Yeah. So, and then the rest is dark energy. I have no idea what they're talking about. But apparently, most of the universe is dark energy, and the reason we know that is the acceleration of the expansion of the universe. That's... Yeah?
So how does the Higgs boson impart mass?
Impart? Just by interacting with it. Just so the Higgs field, and when the Higgs field sees a particle, it says, hello, sweetie. And it does it depending on its mass. So like, yeah, who knows? It's just a Feynman diagram. It's just a piece of Lagrangian. Yeah, it's how we think everything interacts with vertices. Three things talk to each other at a vertex. Yeah. Yes.
What's the purpose of running the LHC for so many years into the future?
Now, after the Higgs? Well, first of all, we want to measure everything about the Higgs we can. We want to measure all its couplings, meaning what it couples to. So we have to create a lot of Higgses. But then there's this idea that there's something else, and that something else is going to make our theory of the universe make more sense, not be fine-tuned. There's this feeling like somebody needs a knob and they need to tune it to 1 part in 10 to the 23 in order to get our universe. And everybody feels like that's a bad situation. So they want a universe with no knobs, or one knob, but it just, you know, like 0, 1, off. It could be fine-tuned a little bit. You know this idea, fine-tuning, that you shouldn't have to subtract 2 incredibly large numbers to get a small number. That things should just be more obvious. So there's a thing called supersymmetry, which is supposed to solve all those problems. And supersymmetry, oh, good news for the young people. Supersymmetry means that for every particle, there's a sparticle. And so there's a super partner, which also is kind of nice. So you can wear outfits when you think. And all those sparticles have never been found. So you could come and find all the sparticles unless they're not there. So one of the reasons. But it's fun looking for them. There's stop, there's spottom, there's a Wino, Higgsino, Gluino, Bino. Anyway, Neutralino. It's very fun. But anyhow, the point is, we believe that there's, you know, going on the energy frontier, you're not just looking for new particles, you're looking for anything new that's interesting. So we believe that there'll probably be something. If not, we'll just build a bigger machine. The bigger machine is either in China, because they're really good at building really big machines, or it will go under Lake Geneva, all the way through CERN, down into France on the bottom side, all under the mountains. And yeah, Trump's going to pay for it. Probably costs the same as the wall. Sorry, don't listen. I was kidding. Donald. Yeah. Yes, there was a... How many different, you know, it's all statistical, so, you know, hundred, on the level of hundreds, yeah. It's a, but it's there. It's there, but we don't know whether it behaves exactly like we think it behaves, but the standard model has been incredibly predictive over the since I was a kid. So everybody's thinking of the worst. You know, now, can I just say now when we find a 3 standard deviation signal in our data, you ask everybody on the experiment, how do you feel? And they say, I don't feel anything. You say, really? Why are you looking at that? Why are you looking more at that data? There's a kind of sense of being incredibly politically, statistically correct, and at the same time, incredible hope and dreams of finding something new. So it's kind of a weird place, but very weird in a really nice way. Yeah. Yes?
Is there any limits to how much can you go down when you break down the sub-estimate particle?
So, well, there's a limit. So, if you want to look at a certain size, like, so for instance, supposing the quarks had small dogs inside them, really small dogs, you would have to use a wave to look at them where the wavelength was smaller than the dog. Okay? Does that make sense? So how do you get the... So the whole point of a particle accelerator is to make waves with small wavelengths, because particles are waves. That's the thing. You heard that, right? So we get down to 10 to the minus 18 meters now. That's the smallest. So we can look inside the quark, and we can say, is there a dog about 10 to the minus 18 meters in there? And the answer is no. But we have no idea at 10 to the minus 19 meters. Does that help? So far we know that electrons and quarks are point-like to the level of 10 to the minus 18 meters. Can you go down? I guess the farthest you could go down was the Planck scale. Yeah, is that? Okay, so the problem is you need the wavelength is directly inversely proportional to the momentum of the particle. So your accelerator would have to go up by 5 orders of magnitude in momentum in order to go 5 orders of magnitude down in size you're looking at. And you know what? Not in my lifetime. Unless one of you comes up with a way to accelerate particles in this space. Who's working on laser? Nobody? Nothing. Okay, well, it's a problem of accelerator physics. It could be solved, but I don't know how to solve it. Yeah?
I just had a question on state of fuel. So how do you differentiate the different types of state of fuels we have? So for instance, in the early universe, we had inflation.
Yeah.
So how do you differentiate the scale of fuel that causes inflation and the Higgs field?
How do we differentiate it? You mean, how do we know it's a scalar field?
Yeah.
Oh, well, so when you make a particle, it will be a scalar particle. And then when it decays to other particles, which you know the spin of, you can figure out, just from the kinematics, whether it's a scalar or not. Right? Is that...
So are we sure that the Higgs field causes inflation's role?
No. We know that there's a Higgs field. Well, we think there's a... We know there's a Higgs boson. We believe there's a Higgs field. We don't know exactly what it caused or not in inflation, I would say, from an experimentalist point of view. Okay, can I go home now? Can I just say, I really like this audience. You've been very nice, and I wanted to just thank you for being here.